Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I want to talk about simple data types, expressions and their operations, and denotational semantics. So let's get started. So what is a data type? A data type, you might have encountered it before, is a way of structuring the contents of the memory of a computer. Now, a data type, it can be understood as being a set of possible values. And suppose you have somewhere a region in memory. Obviously, it's represented as a sequence of zeros and ones. But then the sequence of zeros or ones are digital encoding of some value. Now, the set of possible values is captured by a data type. And so a data type indicates what are its values. Now, this set of values have something in common, namely that you want to have the similar meaning. Eh? And as I give you later some examples of data types, you want that all its values share something. For instance, you could have a data type that represents the day of the week. Well, then the Mondays and the Tuesdays are different values, but what they have in common are that they both are days of the week. Now, a data type is not only the set of values that have a common meaning. We often also want to define operations on those values. And those operations you can think of as, say, functions. And the arity of the operation is how many values of the data type you take, and the operation then produces a new value. A typical example of an operation would, for instance, be addition on numbers. So, a typical operation that is shared by all data types is called value equality. It takes two values of the same data type and then checks, are these two values the same? Well, clearly, if they are the same value, then they are the same. But if you have different values, then they are not the same, and then they are not equal. So, Monday is not Tuesday. And one is not zero. So this notion of value equality is what is common in every data type. Further, there are different two different ways of partitioning data types. Namely, you have the finite data types in which the set of its values is finite. There are only finitely many values in that data type. Or you have an infinite data type. And that means that the set of values is infinite. I already said something about this digital encoding, but it is necessary for every data type to be able to encode its value digitally, because otherwise, how do you store it in the memory of a computer? And because every value must have a unique digital encoding, so different values have different encodings, you could see how would you implement value equality. Well, if you have the same value, then they must have the same digital encoding, because different values cannot be encoded by the same digital sequence of zeros or ones. So checking whether two values are equal then is very simple. Just check whether they have the same encoding. But because every value must have a unique digital encoding, it is the case, even for infinite data types, that you can enumerate all its possible values. And how would you do that? Well, think of it. You start with maybe a single digit, and then you try out the zero, you try out the one. Maybe these are not valid encodings, so maybe there is not a value that uses those digits as an encoding. Well, then you keep on going, so say 0 0 0 1 1 0 1 1, and you try out all the possible sequences of zeros or ones, And since you can enumerate all those sequences of zeros and ones, you can then also enumerate all the possible values of a data type, because they must be encoded to some finite sequence of zeros or ones, so that will eventually then be enumerated. Okay, so this is a quite an abstract description of what a data type is. Let me give you some concrete examples of data types. So a well-known data type is that of the Booleans. By the way, it's called the Booleans because it refers to George Boole. So that's the Boole with the E here. And he, in his article or about, well, you could say it was a treaty on thought. I don't remember the exact title, but I'll put it in the description. He discriminated that there are only two values, that of true and falsehood. And these two values are represented digitally, perhaps by a zero or a one. So it's very easy to digitally encode Booleans. It's a finite data type. You only have two values, true and false. You can imagine the operation of value equality. True is only equal to true. And true is not equal to false. It's a different value. And false is equal to false itself. But false is not equal to true, that those are different values. Another example of a data type would be, I already told you, the days of the week. The Monday, the Tuesday, etc., Sunday. An example would be, for instance, of an operation. What is the next day? Given a day, what is the next day? Well, that's a very nicely defined operation, because Tuesday is the next day of Monday. And what is the next day after the Sunday? Well, that is again the Monday, yeah? So for every value, there is a unique next day. Another example of a data type would be the time of the day. You can immediately see it's digitally encoding. It's digital encoding because we basically have the hours, the colon, and then the minutes. Those are already digital. Now, they are finite because there are only 24 hours in a day, and every hour has only 60 minutes. So the number of different values in the data type time of the day is finite. More commonly used when you do low-level programming on a machine would be the integers that are stored in a fixed size register, say, or addressable in memory. And typically the unit that you work with is the byte, and the byte consists of 8-bit or 2 nibbles. It's actually quite funny, that it's called bit, nibble, byte. They're all just enlargements of the notion of eating, but I'm not sure what to eat now. The signed integers, there's a special encoding of it. Is the set of integers that range from the minimal value minus 128 up to the maximum value of 127. And you can imagine being operations being defined on these, on this data type, that you can, for instance, perform an addition of an integer, an 8-bit integer, with another 8-bit integer. Now, you could also have unsigned integers. So that it is called signed means that there is an additional sign, namely the minus sign, that is part of the value. But if you have unsigned integers, you can use the same 8-bit, but now you can represent, well, the same amount of numbers, but it's shifted. It's no longer representing the negative numbers, it's only representing the positive numbers and zero. So the unsigned 8-bit integers are those from zero, the minimum value, to 255, the maximum value. So that makes them 2 to the power 8 possible values, which clearly coincides with the intuition that we encode it as an 8-bit value, where each bit has two possibilities, either 1 or a 0, which is 2 to the power 8 possibilities then, if we can choose for each bit a true or a false or a 1 or a 0 value. Well, and then you can imagine if you have 8-bit, so that's byte-sized integers, you can also have 32-bit integers or 64-bit integers, signed, unsigned. But they are all finite. Eh? Those data types are all finite. But there is also the data type of the natural numbers. And the natural numbers is an infinite data type. So that becomes a little bit more difficult to encode digitally. It's not as easy to work with fixed units of bits, for instance, sequenced in memory. You need to use special encodings to encode arbitrary sized natural numbers on computers. But it's a proper data type. Another example of a data type would be the integers. It's an infinite data type. That is including the natural numbers. So the natural numbers start with zero, but the integers include the negative numbers. Now you can imagine operations being defined on all of these data types. Eh? Now, suppose that you have these operations. What we want to do is, in our programming language, express what we want to do with values of a particular data type. And so for that we introduce expressions, and many programming languages have all kinds of different sorts of expressions. So one kind of expressions are the ones shown now. These are the Boolean expressions. But it depends, of course, on your programming language what syntax is used. But let's say we pick this syntax to make it a bit concrete. Now, what makes a Boolean expression? You can see here B and F, so Backus-Naur form. It's a grammar, and that recognizes Boolean expressions. What are the components of Boolean expressions? Well, you could use variables, or variable names to be technically correct, to refer to maybe some storage somewhere in the memory that then has the contents that is then seen to mean one of the Boolean values, a true or a false. You could have constants, that is the textual representation of a fixed value, say the true and false constants. And you can have operations. And these operations, they are themselves taking another Boolean expression. So for instance, you have the negation operation. It takes a Boolean expression and then you negate it. Or you have the value equality operation. It takes two Boolean expressions. And then you can ask yourself, are these Boolean expressions having the same value? Eh? That gives you then an equality operation that you can express. You have conjunction, disjunction, exclusive disjunction, and there could be others as well. And now, as you can see in this grammar, I use parentheses if you want to get rid of them. Well, remember from previous weeks, there are tricks, of course, to create shorter expressions with the potential introduction of some ambiguity, but we can resolve that with operator precedences and association. So this gives you an idea, okay, I have in my program some piece of text which expresses a Boolean. Now you can also have expressions for other data types. And so you can also imagine that you have expressions for integers. Well, and by the way, I call these A for arithmetic. Eh? Now these integer expressions, you again have variables to refer to some kind of storage in memory, which then is interpreted as containing maybe an integer. You can have constants, but for the integers you have many constants. So then from the program text you can see, I recognize a number. So and the number itself can then be interpreted as having that same value as a constant in your expression. And you again have operations on integers. So to express those operations, you could have negation, value equality, you could have addition, subtraction, multiplication, maybe others, exponentiation. And different programming languages could use different kinds of syntax. And most often, they're now represented again with parentheses. We get rid of these parentheses because that's a lot of writing by introducing again these disambiguation rules of operator precedence and association. And then you can recognize in your program pieces of text that then represent integer expressions. But now you should maybe ask yourself the question, okay, how does the machine, when it sees the program text, know what is the intended meaning of an expression? An expression is just purely textual, syntactical form. But how does the machine know what to do with these forms? Well, for that, we can talk about what the interpretation of an expression is. To us humans, we have learned in school, for instance, arithmetic. So whenever we see an arithmetical expression or an integer expression, we know what it means. We could, for instance, do it. If you see 2 plus 2, you can perform the operation maybe in your head. But to a machine, this is not as easy as that. So we need to have a way of explaining what the machine does when it sees particular expressions like Boolean expressions or integer expressions. But before we go there, it might be also interesting to recognize that in some programming languages, you can, you might have noticed that in the Boolean expressions, we use the equals symbol, but in the integer expressions, we have also used the equals symbol. And this is basically then is called overloading the notation. So the notation of equals, depending on the context, may mean different things. So whenever you do arithmetic and then you have an arithmetical expression on the left and right and put an equals in between, you want to express, you want it to give the meaning, are these two arithmetical expressions having the same integer value? But whenever you have two Boolean expressions and you put an equal sign in between, you want to express, do these Boolean expressions have the same value? But then, okay, we have overloading. You could also imagine having expressions where we don't clearly separate out what is the Boolean part and what is the integer part. And these are, you could call, mixed expressions. So in mixed expressions, we throw all these operators on one big pile. And so we have addition, multiplication, but we also have conjunction and disjunction all thrown on one pile. And now it depends on the context of what is meant by such mixed expressions. The benefit of having these mixed expressions is that you can then also express different kinds of operators, such as the conditional operator. It's an example of an operator with three arguments. In this case, we have something before the question mark, something after the question mark, and after the colon. And then the conditional operator, it could take, say, a Boolean expression on the left, so on the left of the question mark, and then it could take, for instance, a Boolean expression on the right of the question mark and on the right of the colon, but it could also take integer expressions on the right of the question mark and on the right of the colon. So an example mixed expression that makes use of this conditional operator would be, for instance, the way constructed like this, and you can check if x conjunction with y, that's clearly a Boolean part. Well, question mark 2, hey, that's clearly an integer expression, colon 3. Now, I already hinted to it, I'll come back to that later, but you could ask yourself, what is the intended meaning of such an expression? Well, intuitively, the conditional expression or the conditional operator wants to know the truth value of the expression on the left of the question mark. It queries, is this expression evaluating to true? And if that is indeed the case, then the value of the whole operator becomes the same as the value of the expression to the right of the question mark. But if the truth value of the first argument, so on the left of the question mark, is false, then the value of the conditional operator becomes the value of the third argument, so on the right of the colon. And so in the case of this example here, suppose that we have x and y. Suppose x is false, well then x and y must also be false. And if it's false, then the whole result of this conditional operator must equal to 3. But I'm running ahead a little bit here. There are also, in mixed expressions, so-called casting operators. And casting is an operation that brings a value of one data type into another data type. So you could, for instance, have, say, a Boolean expression, and now you want to cast that Boolean expression when it evaluates to a Boolean value, you want to cast it into an integer expression, so that the result is an integer. And then you could, for instance, say, well, the meaning of a casting operator depends on which data types are mapped to which other, or cast to other data types. So for instance, we could say the any positive integer is mapped to true, zero is mapped to false, and any negative integer is mapped to true as well. And this often depends also on the machine representation, the digital encoding of a data type. Another casting operator would be, well, what if we start with an integer and then we want to cast it into a Boolean? Oh, sorry, that was the example I just gave. Huh? So we have the positive integers that become true, the negative integers that become true, and the zero that becomes false. So here we say have an integer expression and the result has a Boolean value. But if you have, say, a Boolean value in between and you want to cast it to an integer, you could say, well, let's map true to 1 and false to 0. That's also a possible operation that you could do. Some examples. So 2 plus 3 is the value 5. And now 5 is an integer. What if we want to cast it to the Boolean data type? Well, we could say positive, so it must be true. Then the value of this operator becomes true if you apply it with the sub-expression 2 plus 3. And oppositely, you could say, well, what if you want to cast, for instance, the true constant to an integer? Well, we could say, just map it to 1. Okay, there are other operators that you can now use in mixed expressions. For instance, you could have relations. So relations, you could imagine, like, if you have an integer on the left and an integer on the right, and then you can ask yourself, is it the case that the integer on the left is smaller than the integer on the right? Well, if that is the case, then the result must be true. And if that's not the case, then the result must be false. And so you can imagine that you have then also relational operators that evaluate to say true or false, depending on the integer values. But you can also have relational operators on Boolean values. This entirely depends on the programming language. An example would be 5. Is it smaller than or equal to 3? Well, it's not. And 2, is it smaller than 8? Yes, it is. So you could then think of the value of this operator being the relation smaller than or equal. This one, the value here must be true. Well, sorry, the value here must be false. And the value here must be true. So whenever you mix things around, you want to maybe keep track of which part of the expression belongs to which data type. And this is called type information, that you associate two expressions. What is the intended data type that this expression is to be interpreted in, to be given a meaning in? And because with operator overloading, for instance, this equality symbol, you might not know, if you just look at the text and not know what the type is, how to do the operation. And so the meaning of the operation might depend on this type, the type of its sub-expressions, for instance. Now, and different languages have different approaches here. Some languages that use static type information infer from the program text, or require you as a programmer to put annotations in your text to add the type information, for instance, to variables or to arguments or functions, say, to explicitly specify, I expect a certain type here. But other languages can infer this at runtime. So then they have type information, but they don't infer it from the program text. No, they just on the fly, whenever it is executing, will figure out whatever is the data type of a certain expression. And only at the last moment, then using this dynamic runtime dependent information, decide on what the meaning is of a particular, say, operator that it then wants to execute. And this already gives you sort of an idea that we could maybe prevent certain programming errors if we help the programmer whenever we load in its program, say in our compiler or interpreter, that we can then detect errors in your program by checking whether the types of the expressions are, for instance, compatible with the expected types of, say, operators. And this process is called type checking. And in a couple of weeks, we will look into type checking in more detail. But now you already know on what where we could apply it. It's certainly whenever we want to express certain arithmetical or Boolean or other data type expressions, that it is useful if we mix everything together, that we can then later check whether such mixed expressions actually makes sense to the computer when it has to execute it. So an example of something that doesn't really type check in a strict programming language would be, for instance, this mixed expression. And you could ask, well, 2 question mark true colon 1 plus false times 1 conjunction true. And so we are mixing here the types. For instance, what is the conjunction of a 1, which is an integer, and true, which is a Boolean constant? So it depends on how the programming language deals with this. Now, for instance, you could have implicit casts. Some programming languages have implicit casts. So then whenever you have these mixed expressions that don't make much sense because the operator is not defined on mixed data types, that it then tries to cast the expressions to something for which there is a known interpretation, for which the meaning is known. But other programming languages do not have implicit casts and require you explicitly, if you want to make use of it, to insert casting operators. And then it can help the programmer detect errors, typing errors, for instance, or where you mix up inadvertently expressions by raising a type checking error after parsing the program and doing the type checking. And that can help the programmer detect errors before even running the program. Okay, so back to this original idea of what we want to do with these expressions. So the expressions are part of some program text, and now the machine, either a compiler, wants to translate it into a format that the processor can then work with, or we want to interpret it, so run the program without compiling it first to a machine format. But we want to know what the intended meaning of our operators in our expressions are. And how can we say something about that? Well, for that we have the notion or the concept of semantics. So what is the meaning of a program, or what in this case is the meaning of an expression? But there is a particular style of giving this semantics. So it's a way of thinking about how to give this semantics. So that is called denotational semantics. But then denotational semantics, what is the word denotation? And this comes from, it's typically used in the following context. I give you this expression x plus 5 times y. Then what does this expression denote as a value? What is the denotation of this expression? So that depends entirely on what is the value of x and y. X and y are variables, right? So if we don't know what the value of x and y is, they're variables, so they might on the machine be stored somewhere in memory where there is a digital encoding of a value. Well, it entirely depends on what are the values assigned to those variables before we can know what is the meaning of this expression. So already the meaning of this expression, you can see, depends on, well, what is the value at runtime stored in a particular variable, for instance. But furthermore, we could also ask ourselves, well, this is an integer expression, but there are many kinds of data types that look like integers. We could have the finite data types, like the 8-bit signed or unsigned integers. So we can have the mathematical integers, the infinite data type. So which data type do we use? Different data types have different meanings of the operators. So we need to know what data type that we use. And then if we know what the data types are that we want to use, we can ask ourselves, but what do these operators then mean? What does plus mean and what does times mean? I mean, you and I know what it means because we have practiced with that, but the machine doesn't know that. We have to somehow be able to express what the meaning is of this expression in such a format that the machine can do something with it. So, and also the question is, there are certain expressions maybe that don't have a value. If you want to ask yourself, what is the meaning of an expression? For instance, say I want to do x divided by 0. What is its meaning? Maybe it doesn't have a meaning, and we should signal to the machine, or that we should signal an error. There is a programming error. Someone tries to divide by 0 here. That's not allowed. Could maybe crash the system or report some error that the user then can fix it. So it is not always the case that an expression actually has a value, right? So most of the times we want expressions to have a defined value. Okay, so then we now know what the denotation is of an expression, then the style of giving a semantics to expression that revolves all around giving a denotation to expression is called denotational semantics. So now I'll explain you what denotational semantics is by example. I mean, itself, denotational semantics is an advanced topic. You could follow a course in it, but we'll keep it to the surface here. So to give you a sort of an idea of what it is. And this is useful also as a programmer to know, okay, so this is how you can confer your intention to the machine, because the machine interprets it in a certain way. And that certain way is denotational semantics. So given some data type, say the integers. Now, state is an assignment of variables to values in your data type. And as you saw before, our Boolean expressions and our integer expressions could include in its expression the variable names. Now, in a state, variables, those the variables named by our variables, are assigned particular values. So at each instant, you could say the state of the machine assigns to particular variables some value in a data type. Now, if we know what the values are of the variables in an expression, then we can try to evaluate what is the value of the whole expression then. And we do that by building up the value of the expression piece by piece. So ultimately then, we assign to the whole expression, in which the variables are sort of the leaves of the abstract syntax tree, but the whole expression is assigned ultimately a value, and that is the intended value of the expression. So consider, okay, not the integers, let's take the booleans as a data type. Then, and suppose we assign x to true and y to false, then by this notation, with the double bracket, under the state sigma, we mean the value of our Boolean expression in that state sigma. So the Boolean expression itself is some kind of, it was defined by a grammar, is some kind of string of symbols. But by asking ourselves, okay, what is this string of symbols? What is the meaning of this string of symbols? What value does it have? We need to know what are the values that the variables are assigned to that can occur within the expression. And then we can know what is the value of the overall expression. So then as an example, say you have this expression, x and y, conjunction, and then we have another conjunction with z or not z. Okay, so then what is the value of this expression? So we ask ourselves, this is just a string of symbols, and now the string of symbols, given our state where we have assigned x to true and y to false, we want to know what is then the value of this Boolean expression. Now, to give you the idea what you do with denotational semantics is that you either go top-down or you go bottom-up. right? So if you take the abstract syntax tree of this expression, you can see that the topmost node is this conjunction. So then we want to first know what is the value of the left conjunct, and then we want to know what is the value of the right of the conjunction. And if we know that, then we can know what is the value of the conjunction. Well, and then from the top, we go down one level. We can again ask ourselves, hey, what is now the value of this expression on the left? Well, that's again a conjunction. So then to determine the value of this expression, we need to go again deeper in the abstract syntax tree and ask ourselves, what is the value of this variable? Hey, but the variable we know in our state has been assigned a value, namely true. So we know that x must be true in our state. And y also is assigned a value, namely false. So we know that here we have something that is true, and here we have something that is false. False. So if we know the values of the arguments, then we can imagine that there is a function associated to each operator that gives you then the value of the operator given the values of its arguments. In the case of conjunction, both have to be true for the result to be true, and otherwise the result is false. Well, and since y in this case is false, the result of this conjunction is false. But since then we have then on the left of this conjunction here, we also have a false value. So then the result here of the overall expression must be false. Hey, but we didn't even have to look on the right-hand side. But then it depends on the programming language what it does, right? Either it evaluates it and then has obtained the value of both the left and the right, and only then finds out what is the overall expression, or it is kind of lazily doing it. But to that topic, I will return in a future lecture. For now, let's assume that we are very strict. We just go top down and we start asking ourselves, what's the value of our arguments? What's the value of our arguments? What's the value of our arguments? And then when we are at the least, there are the variables, and the variables are assigned a value in a state. So that's what we then immediately know. And then we bubble up the values in the abstract syntax tree. And if you want to know more about how this goes and how you could implement something like this, then you can read in the Sebesta book about attribute grammars. There it's really explained how you could implement a denotational semantic. But for now, let's continue on this more abstract. This mapping of expressions to values is also called an evaluation function. And the process of turning some textual expression under a certain state into a value is called evaluation. Okay, so I already said to you how we could do it for our ampersand, but then you could ask yourself, of course, how do the other operators work? Before going into that, I should also remark that the state that we use to evaluate these sub-expressions always remain the same state. So while we are evaluating some sub-expression, we don't modify the state, right? Whenever this is the case, our expressions are called pure. They are not side effectful. So that means that the state is not modified during the evaluation process. But there are also programming languages that are more complicated, where the order of evaluation is important. So whether we start on the left or whether we start on the right, for instance, a binary operator, and that the actual evaluation process may itself change the state. So that then it's called an impure expression whenever such a thing happens. Okay, so how do you now define such an evaluation function? We could do it by looking at the structure of our abstract syntax tree. So we recognize in abstract syntax tree whether we have particular operations, and then we need to, for each of these operations, depending on the data types of its sub-expression, give the intended meaning. So to do that, we can assume that we have already established the values of the arguments to the operator. And then the only thing we have to do is to give a function for each operator that then brings the values of the of the arguments to the resulting value of the operator. Well, at the lowest level, whenever you encounter a variable, it's actually quite easy. Eh? So whenever you want to evaluate just a variable, then what you do is, well, look in the state, and then the value that is assigned to the variable in your state then becomes the value of such an expression that only consists of a variable. However, if you encounter a constant, say for instance the Boolean constant, we can immediately take that constant as the value of that expression. And so the constant true, whenever you want to evaluate it, it doesn't really care about the state because it always gives you back the value true. And now the constant false, if you evaluate it, gives you the value false. And I should remark here a bit, because the true within the brackets is a textual string of symbol. While the true on the right hand side, this is the value. So this is an element of the set that corresponds to the Boolean data type. So here the computer then basically tries to understand the textual representation in your program that says, hey, I here have a constant. So for instance, say if you're working with the integers, you have multiple different characters that then represent some kind of integer, and it has to turn it into that integer's value. So the interpretation of these constants may involve translating the textual representation into its digital encoding of the value itself. Now, if you have operators, the importance is that you first try to determine the value of its sub-expressions. And then whenever the value of all sub-expressions are known, then we can define the value of the operator where in terms of the value of its sub-expression. So in the case, for instance, that we do negation with sub-expression B, then the first thing we want to do is evaluate B in the same state. And whenever this B then evaluates to say false, the value false, then the negation of B then becomes true. But if, say, B evaluates in the state sigma to true, well, then the value of the negation of B must be false. So flipping the truth value, so to say, here. And similarly, we could define the meaning of binary operators. Here is some example. You could do it using tables. The conjunction already I said informally, but here you can just say, oh, well, here you have a lookup table. You look up what is the value of my sub-expression and what is my value of my sub-expression. If both are false, then the value of my overall expression also is false. If one of them is true, the result is still false. But if both of them are true, then the resulting value of my conjunction becomes true. And you can do the same thing for disjunction. The disjunction becomes true whenever one of the two sub-expression evaluates to true. And whenever you check, for instance, the equality of two Boolean expressions, well, you just first determine the value of the first expression, then you determine the value of the second expression. And if they are both the same, for instance, both are false, well, then the result must be true because they are equal. But if both are true, then the result is also true because they're equal. If they're different, then the result is false. And now the exclusive OR is sort of the complement of this operation. So whenever they are the same, then the result of the disjunctive OR is false. But whenever they're different, then the result of the disjunctive exclusive disjunction is true. So you could imagine giving all these tables. And similar to, for instance, arithmetical expressions. You could give multiplication tables, or you could give a table of how to do addition. And now you could store these tables, of course, in memory, or you could build them in some hardware circuit where you can then perform these operations. There are different ways of implementing the meaning of these operators. Okay, so as an exercise to practice a little bit with defining an evaluation function, I already said to you, well, you could use these multiplication tables. Well, try to figure it out how it should work, for instance, for 8-bit signed integers or unsigned integers. You could also try to think of, what if we have mixed expressions? How can you then define the operators? And then you have to think, hey, maybe these operators have different meanings depending on the data type of the sub-expressions. If a sub-expression gives you a Boolean, and say you want to say Boolean plus some integer value, what is then the resulting value? And you might also there want to say, no, I'm leaving things undefined, or I could signal some error. Eh? So I want, in my programming language, I want to, if I do a false plus an integer, it should be an error. And you could, different programming languages have different ways of assigning meaning to these operators. And typically in the reference manual of each programming language, it is stated how these operators and the evaluation function is defined. Okay, so I still want to talk a little bit more about denotational semantics, because whenever you're given expressions, and I don't care about the data type here, but let's, for concreteness, just take Boolean expressions. You could ask yourself whether the two expressions always have the same value. So regardless of the state, whenever you evaluate one, whenever you evaluate the other, they must have the same value. Well, if that is the case, you could call the expressions equivalent. That they must have the same value in every state. And then that's also written with these three bars instead of these two, to indicate that the expression, so this syntactical string of symbols, has under every possible state, the same evaluates to the same value as the second expression. Okay, and if you have that, then we can see that in certain definitions of this evaluation function, there is a nice property. And this is a quite an important concept. It's the concept of compositionality. Denotational semantics is called compositional whenever it is the case that as soon as you recognize two expressions that are equivalent, that you could substitute one for the other. And this is more abstractly also understood by saying equivalence is compatible with the structure of expressions. If this is the case, then you call the denotational semantics compositional. So more examples of how we could see that is, suppose that B and B prime are two different expressions, but they are equivalent. So that means they always have the same value regardless of the state. Then it is also the case that the negation of B must be equivalent to the negation of B prime. Yeah? If we have, for instance, that B1 is equivalent to B prime 1, and we have that B2 is equivalent to B prime 2, then it is also the case that whenever we take the conjunction of B1 and B2, that it is equivalent to the conjunction of B prime 1, B prime 2. Okay, so why is this compositionality useful, a useful property that holds of your denotational semantics? Well, it allows you to understand expressions by reason. It allows you to easily reason about the value of expressions. Namely, whenever you have established that one expression is equivalent to another expression, you can just replace one by the other. Okay, but maybe you've seen this in the video before as well. There's this notion of referential transparency. And you could think of, what is the difference between referential transparency and compositionality? Interesting. Well, finally, I would like to conclude with, we've seen expressions, for instance, in the lambda calculus before. Can we also not give that a denotational semantics? Well, I'll already tell you that. That's a very advanced topic, so we will not treat that as part of this course. So sometimes this style of giving meaning to expressions is not very suitable. For instance, in the lambda calculus, it's not immediately obvious how you could give value to a lambda expression. It's not very obvious how you could do that. For integer expressions, it's very obvious. For Boolean expressions, it's also obvious. For most simple data types, denotational semantics is quite obvious how you would give it a meaning using denotational semantics. And most of the time, you want that to be compositional, so that you can easily reason about the equivalence of expressions. But for more complicated expressions, like those in the lambda calculus, it's not immediately obvious. And in the next video, I will explain a different style of giving meaning to program text. And that is more suitable, for instance, for the lambda calculus. Okay, thank you for watching this video, and I hope to see you soon again.